Hello, malty manny quines, and thank you to Clay Chains for that malt mention introducing Whisky Review 476 here at Ralphie.com. And I'm Ralphie, and I'm going to talk about this single malt sitting in the barrel here for the next 15 minutes, probably more. We'll see how the time goes, shall we? This, by the way, my merry maltsters, is a rebranded single malt from Scotland, from a very obscure distillery, which way back in the mists of time was highly cherished, not just valued, but cherished by blenders of blended scotch, because it had such substantial character and pleasantness of flavour. However, as happens, some single malts, the star falls. As other stars rise, some stars fall. And certainly in the recent history of Glen Scotia has been the staff in the distillery doing what they can with what they've got, but not really being given the full rein of resources by the owners of the distillery, which would let this malt sparkle. Do you know that in the beginning of the 20th century, Glen Scotia was more highly valued and rated by blenders than Springbank? Now, reason I mention that is because Glen Scotia is, there's only three distilleries in Springbank which form the Campbellton region of whisky: Springbank, Glengyle, and right off the radar, Glen Scotia. But in its own way, a characterful and interesting distillery. So if you're down in Campbellton, you might as well pop along. It's just round the corner. You never know, there might be someone around who could show you around and sell you a bottle. The recent rebranding left me kind of scratching my head a little bit, because they're absolutely right. Bottled at 46%, unchilled, filtered, and natural colour. We like that. Look at that beautiful natural colour. Very commendable. But previous owners have not really invested, in my opinion, and I've got to quantify this and say, in my opinion, from previous Glen Scotias I have tasted through independent bottlers, namely Cadenheads, to be honest, they've not exactly set my heather on fire, if you know what I mean. They have been rather mediocre. I recently previously reviewed a Glen Scotia from the exclusive whisky company, which had been matured in a rum cask and was in fact half and half whisky rum. Such was the intensity of the rum cask influence. But this is the first official bottling of Glen Scotia. And I've picked the 21-year-old because it's an affordable official bottling at that age. And in my opinion, it's the best of the versions that are available. That's why I'm reviewing it for you. The younger versions are still a little bit undermatured. However, well, I would say, in my opinion, if there is one whisky distillery in Scotland which could seriously make its mark and gain a reputation from a thorough reinvestment as a craft distillery, it's Glen Scotia. I mentioned in my previous whisky review, 475, that this was one of the most unusual whiskies that I have ever tasted. I've tasted recently, and I'm sticking to my guns in that one, because as a 21-year-old, as soon as you put your nose to it, you're not getting 21 years, but you're getting something very well matured, perfumed, but still spirit intense. The oak influence has been long-term, but very restrained. You know, I would even imagine second, even third-fill casks have been involved in this batch, along with a small amount of first-fill casks, which have contributed quite a bit. very nicely married together. You get a wonderful little fusty note on the nose, which is reassuring. It's suggesting traditional warehousing. Confectionery, Edinburgh Rock, lemon sweets, icing sugar, Victoria sponge cake, iced cake, fruit, mild fruit, gentlest of sultanas. Just a hint of marine notes, mature, balanced solvent, egg powder. I better double check that one. Sometimes when you're nosing a whiskey, you know something you can't put your finger on. And it's not until you taste that whiskey, taste it, and then go back to nosing it after a couple of minutes, that you realise what that was. Neat, the taste is a little bit peculiar. It's quite eccentric. It reminds me actually a little of Edredour. But I will not be put off by that. There's something slightly unbalanced about it in the flavour. A combination of sour and dry and old saltiness. However, add a drop of water and things start to change. The nose becomes beautifully intense, light, island character. Funnily enough, it reminds me of a bottle of Isle of Arran. How strange, because the distilleries are not that far away from each other. There's a delightful, understated marine note, salty and slight seashell note on the nose. Very intriguing. It's almost as if the sun's going down on a sandy beach, it's some remote spot in Scotland. And that's what it is evocative. You know, I generally, when I'm giving my reviews, I try to remain objective with my tasting notes, describing lemons and grapefruits and bananas. And there's a hint of banana about this as well. But this is a whiskey that I find I'm approaching it more subjectively, because it's a most peculiar, different malt. Initially, when I tried this, I thought to myself, uh-oh, not so sure. However, such is the difference and singularity of this whiskey, this malt, it's actually starting to grow on me. For a 21-year-old, don't expect big cask influence. It's simply not there. It's more a highly evolved, spirit-driven malt. Honey, loads of honey, marine, sweet and sour, slight savoury, sage, definitely. Hint of avocado, bananas, slightly unripe peach, hint of conference pear. It seems a slightly thin whiskey, but at the same time it's got some sort of intensity about it, which I haven't really come across before very often. The arrival, quite spirity, but clean, fresh, cutting. Very ozone. Yeah, that's what it's kind of, get that ozone, fresh breeze sort of flavour to it in the arrival. And the development, complex fresh fruits with marine and some seashell notes. And the finish, very gentle, understated vanilla, mild honey. There is honey actually apparent throughout the flavour. It doesn't have a huge development and finish for the age, but it's what I would call a character malt, definitely. In the rebranding of these whiskies, I think it's a 12-year-old and a 18-year-old. I've forgotten whether there's a 15-year-old, but I do that. You know what I'm like. Head like a sieve, but really quite enjoying this. It's quite a fair price for an official bottling for its age, compared to other single malts out there. Wonderfully, because it's got everything to prove and no big serious reputation, the presentation is craft presentation. It's in a tin, it's practical. There's no overt marketing flannel. I must say the plastic coating around the bottle, it is different, but it doesn't quite work for me. It really lacks kind of old school classiness, to be honest. It's a bit cheesy. However, that's just a personal opinion, and I'm not going to let it detract from the fact that I am enjoying this whiskey. It's different. Here we are, 85 out of 100. It's a malt mark for 21-year-old Glen Scotia from Campbellton. There we go. There you have it. All done and dusted. Another whiskey review. I recommend that you watch you don't get into a malt habit. In other words, if you like peated Islay whiskies, you tend to gravitate towards them. And even when you find them slightly disappointing and slightly underwhelming and perhaps slightly overpriced, it happens, you persevere because you're in your safety zone, your comfort zone. So if you're a fan of peated whiskies, you will stick with peated whiskies. And occasionally you'll buy a fruity Spey Cider, perhaps Glenfarclas, just for a change, but that's about as far as it goes. Likewise, if you happen to quite enjoy sherried whiskies, you'll tend to stick to the likes of Glenfarclas, Springbank, Glendronach, obvious example, and you'll be chasing these sherry bomb moments, and you won't stray far from them. You'll look at bottles like Glen Scotia and say, "I don't know that, so I'm not going to go for it. I'm not going to engage with it." It's the same with my previous review of Glencadam 21-year-old. It's a different while. It's got that classic Eastern Highland, which you don't see much of. You don't really find it in Fettercairn, and you just don't really get it in the underperforming, Royal Lochnagar. The nearest you'll find it is Glengarry. But such a bag loads of character. Challenge your palate, malt mates. Try something different. Even if you're not going to buy a bottle yourself, find someone who's got a bottle and do a sample swap. It's such a good way of broadening your horizons. And remember, as much as you, it's like travel. The more you travel to places that are perhaps a bit beyond your comfort zone, the more you look back into the comfort zone you've come from and say, not quite so comfy there anymore. I've discovered something new, a different perspective, a different view in something, and I've got to know it a little bit better, and I've enjoyed the journey. There we are. I will leave it at that. If you join me again shortly, I will be back with Whiskey Review 477, in which, and I know some of you malt mates have been waiting a long time for this. I'm going to give you a tour round one of my several whiskey stores, showing you a few of the bottles I've bought and tell you why I bought them. Now, that should be interesting. I've done this before, but it's a few years ago. And as you can imagine, my collection has slightly expanded since then. Still, better than money in the bank. That's what I say.